thought about writing a book? They say that inside all of us is at least one great novel. Well, stay tuned, because we're going to talk to two women who have written those books. They got it out. You're watching The Angela DeJoseph Show, and we're talking about what matters. Watching The Angela DeJoseph Show, and you know I have a special love for writers, and tonight's show we're really going to talk about what it takes to write a novel. You know, we think about it, we think, I'd like to write that novel, but what does it really take? How do you get that novel out? My first guest is a friend of mine, and her name is Darlene Hayes. Welcome to the show, Darlene.
Thank you.
I'm so excited to have you here.
Thank you for inviting me here.
Yes. When I found out you wrote a novel, I was like, wow. Remember? I ordered it right away.
Oh, thank you.
Right away on Amazon. And her book is called Man Sharing. Hot topic. But before we get into man sharing, I have to tell you, Darlene was at the top of the field in TV talk shows. You made it all the way to the top, and one of the premiere show really that led the way, the Donahue Show. You were executive producer.
I was senior producer when I left. When I started, I was the person who took tickets from the audience.
Is that right?
Absolutely.
So, how long did it take you to make it through that?
It took me about 6 years, because it wasn't. Nowadays, you're in there for half a minute and you get a promotion, but it took me about 6 years.
So you were in Ohio? Is that where I was,
in Chicago.
In Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but where is that where he started?
He started in Ohio, Dayton, Ohio.
Right, in Ohio. Mm-hmm. So, but what was it like working for Phil Donahue? I mean, this was like a novel thing that he did. What did he do that was so different from talk shows of the day?
At the time, he really talked to the women in the audience. Mm-hmm. And he made them a part of the show. He always said, we have three guests. The audience, the invited guest, and him. So there were three parts to the show, but he always included the audience. And because there's so many shows now that are going back in the audience and talking
mm-hmm,
to women,
mm-hmm.
I sent him an email and I said, I call him Papa Smurf.
Uh-huh.
I see all the little Smurfettes out in the audience with their microphones,
mm-hmm.
but they don't know what color the women's eyes are. They don't know mm-hmm. what color their dresses are. They don't know where they came, how long it took them to get dressed and get to the studio to be a part of that. And he always knew all that. And those are the kind of questions that he solicited from the audience.
My goodness. So from Donahue, where did you go next?
From Donahue, I left. You know, we went from Chicago to New York. In New York, I came out here. And then I was actually a writer on a sitcom for about a season. Amen.
How was that? Different, huh?
It was. It
mm-hmm.
was. It was. It was different. It was hard.
I think you told me a story about being chased around the desk by the
mm-hmm.
top producer or something like that. Yeah.
And then I got back into talk, mm-hmm. and I did a lot of pilots that never made it to air. And then my next big job was with Marcia Warfield.
Oh, right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then after that, Montel. And I was with...
Montel was a great show.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So I...
So you were the senior producer on...
Executive producer of Montel for about 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
And then I did... I'm trying to remember. Then I left and did a lot of consulting work, you know, with... I did some shows with BET. I did some shows for ABC. I did some shows for the Food Network.
Oh, okay.
You know, actually, I sort of restructured Emeril. Remember Emeril?
Mm-hmm.
Emeril
mm-hmm.
Live.
Yes, yes.
Emeril from the little show to Emeril to the big show.
Yes.
I did that, and I
okay.
and I got the equivalent of what would be an Emmy now. Back then, it was the ACE Awards.
But the ACE Awards.
Mm-hmm. I got an Emmy or ACE Awards for that show. And then I did some more consulting work. Then I went to work for Tom Joyner.
Ah.
And I did all of the productions he did for TV One.
Okay. Well, let's talk about Montel. Montel was a different, because we hadn't really seen a brother like that. He was strong. Mm-hmm. He was masculine. He was just charismatic.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what was it like working for Montel?
It was also interesting because, you know, Montel was a lieutenant colonel in the Navy, and that's where he came out of. So he had all that Navy discipline, and, you know, and you have your rankings. So I remember one time we had a show on where he had a congresswoman, and he had a person from the audience.
Okay.
And the person from the audience disagreed with the congresswoman. Montel marched up to him like, "Sir, you are speaking to an official of this country." We were like, no, that's not the way it works here. But he took all that discipline and brought it to the show, and that's what made him so masculine and so authoritative in terms of the way he did the show.
Now, Wesley Buford. Now, Wesley, dear friend, rest in peace, Wesley.
Yeah.
But Wesley claimed that he's the one that discovered Montel. I don't know if that's a true story. Is that a true story?
Wesley didn't discover Montel, but Wesley brought Montel into the spotlight.
Okay.
So that's how I would describe it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, those were some fun days.
There was a lot of.
I remember you worked on Alex Trebek's show too.
I did. You remember that?
Well, you know what? This is what's really cool. You know, when you have friends that are the producers. See, I worked in front of the camera, and I got to work on their shows. So you got me on there, and I did. I did a show, and I loved Alex Trebek.
Yeah.
He was just wonderful.
Yeah, I've been around a long time, haven't I?
Just a little bit. Well, you know, but hey.
But it's a good thing. You know what? I've worked, which a lot of people can't say this, I worked 25 years freelance in Los Angeles, and only for the last few years did I not have work. So it was consistent, it was great, and I had a lot of great experiences.
So what's different now? I mean, from the time of, you know, Donahue, then of course Oprah came on the scene, and we had for a while there, we had everybody. It was Ricky Lake, it was Sally Jesse Raphael. It seemed like it was like every station had 4 or 5 talk shows.
Well, they're back.
They're back.
Because you have Bethany, you have Queen Latifah, you have Steve Harvey.
That's right.
I forgot, and the other ones, they
Wendy Williams.
I mean, they're back because compared to doing soap operas or other shows, you know, talk shows are relatively cheap. You pay your host, you know, the audience is free. You know, you pay your guests who are coming in to do promotions for whatever they're doing. So, you know, so that cycle is back.
It's back again.
And the other cycle that is back is game shows. So, which, again, they say, call it reality TV. All of it's real because you're using real people and real situations. So it's not just going into people's homes and watching what they do, watching them fight, really. But
Making them fight, being captured on camera.
So that's what's what's different now is that, sorry for actors and writers, they're capturing the drama of real life.
And now everybody can have a talk show because of the internet.
Absolutely, and that's a good thing.
Yeah, it's great because, you know, there's so many voices that you don't get to hear. And now you have, even like on this station, on LATalkLive.com, we have everybody, all different kind of people on here. You could listen to hip hop. You can learn about books. You can learn about what you do about your business. You have health. You have, and then you have me that talks about what matters. So,
but no, I think that's a wonderful thing. I think that this is the greatest time in terms of the internet and how videos and movies can be done so cheaply now. Like there's so much talent out here that never had the opportunity because they had to go through the big production company. So I think this is a great time.
Well, you know, I lost count really, but I know I was on at least 300 because I was on everything, you know, Regis and Kathy and Hour Magazine and AMLA and all the Montel, every show. But I always wanted to be in their seat.
Okay.
And I want to be that, you know, and but you know, you get kind of pigeonholed in the business and people see you a certain way.
You do.
And so this is great because now I get to be in this seat.
You get to be you.
I get to be the one asking the questions. Yay. And it's kind of fun. But I do want to talk about the fact that you have written a book, a novel. How long did it take you to write Man Sharing? How long did it take you to write this?
From concept to the book, 3 years.
3 years. Now, how did you come up with this idea for Man Sharing?
Well, you know, I've had to share I had to share my man.
Willingly?
But it wasn't it wasn't my decision.
Okay.
So, you know, I kind of, you know, coming from that background of talk shows and trying to figure out something to talk about that hasn't been talked about yet, I thought, what if it was flipped? You know, so this book is about two young women who agree to share a man as their sex toy and not tell him. So they made that agreement before they knew who the man was going to be. So the book actually is about the journey of their friendship once they made that decision.
So now, do you have any friends that have ever been in that situation where they were willingly sharing a man?
I've gotten so much information.
I bet you have.
From people that I know who all of a sudden want to share their man-sharing stories.
Okay.
Of two women who are friends, both sat down and told me about a man they shared.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Very interesting. Well, you know, I think this is a good place to take a break because I take a little cool down. And when we come back, we're talking to Darlene Hayes. We're talking about her book, Man Sharing. We'll be right back. You're watching The Angela DeJoseph Show.
Those who've been waiting for health insurance. Welcome to Covered California, the place to find quality, affordable coverage, and nobody can be denied because of a pre-existing condition. Learn more at coveredca.com.
Hey everyone, this is Richard Carr, Business Relations Manager for LA Talk Live. Did you know social media produces almost double the marketing leads of trade shows, telemarketing, direct mail, or even pay-per-click ads? And that about 46% of all online users count on social media when making that ever-important purchase decision. Hey, if you feel lost when it comes to social media, Top Tier Media can help you. Top Tier Media specializes in social media management and blogger outreach for beauty, fashion, health, and lifestyle brands. To learn more, go to www.toptiermedia.com. That's www.toptiermedia.com. Top Tier Media, the official social media marketing company of LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network.
Hi, this is Elena inviting you to join me every Wednesday at noon for Elena's Beauty Talk and more, exclusively on LA Talk Live. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, R&B, or watch us on Ustream.tv, reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
You're watching The Angela DeJoseph Show. We have a hot topic going on. We're talking about man sharing. I'm not sharing my man. I don't have a man, but if I had one, I wouldn't share him. But anyway, Darlene Hayes is here. She wrote the book, Man Sharing. So we're talking about real people that have this going on. So tell us a juicy story somebody told you.
I don't know how juicy it is. They didn't give me details because it was not a menage a trois situation.
Okay.
It was a man that they both liked, but neither was interested in any long-term relationship. So they, you know, they shared him.
And they just, they flipped, like, who got him on, you know, holidays? You get him for Thanksgiving, I get him for Christmas. I mean.
No, they were just, I don't think it was that planned out.
Okay.
I think they both were going out with them, both having sex with them. They were still friends, but it was sort of like, you know, they would tell each other that they had been out with him, but I don't think it was, you know, I don't think it had a schedule or anything, because
it wasn't like Sister Wives.
No, it wasn't like Sister Wives at all.
Now, I heard some statistic one time where someone said that Black women are more likely to be kidnapped by a terrorist than to get married. That it's just so bad out here, statistically, the number of Black men to Black women that perhaps we should consider sharing.
Yes, I heard that too. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know what, I had a conversation with another woman, and I think in a lot of ways some of us share, but it doesn't have, it's there's no sex involved. Mm. Because there's not a man in your house, your girlfriend's husband might come over and fix things for you.
Oh, mm-hmm,
you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Or, and another woman told me, she said, oh, man sharing. She said, oh, I share my girlfriend's husband. I was like, ooh, juicy story. Mm-hmm. And she said, oh, no, he likes baseball. I like baseball. Okay. You know, we go to the game and the wife is happy because she doesn't want to go to the game with him. So there's all different levels of man sharing.
Well, you know what? Actually, I have a friend, and when I have to go to a fancy, you know, to do, she let her husband take me.
So you're man sharing too, Angela.
Yeah, I am. So I didn't think of it that way. Oh. Yeah, I was sharing. But you know what? You know, but that's probably because she wanted to go out, probably. She's like, yeah, Angela, it's okay. He can go with you. And then she's tipping out the back door. Something like that. Okay. So tell us about the book. Tell us about the characters, a little bit about them. How did you formulate the characters?
Well, you know, they say write about what you know. So one of my characters, of course, is overworked television producer.
Mm-hmm.
And she doesn't have time to look for a man. You know, she works 24/7, you know, on call 24/7. And the other character I would describe, Lexi is the other character. Nina's the producer. Lexi's the other character. She's kind of a gold digger.
Mm.
So she's waiting for that man who's going to take care of her, that she doesn't have to work or do anything. And she wants him to have power because she wants to be a socialite. So while she, you know, they're having drinks and they're, you know, getting ripped. Mm-hmm. So she was like, girl, she said, why don't we find a man to share just for sex until we can find the right husbands?
Mm.
So that's how they came to this agreement. So it was sort of like, okay, you know, let's share him. And then we'll come back and compare stories and talk about him and, you know.
So now, what does he look like? I mean, give us a movie star.
Oh, my God. I want him to be common.
Oh, okay. Share common.
That's who I had in my mind. Okay. His name is D-Mac.
Okay.
Which stands for, I forgot what his real name is. It's D-Mac, because everybody likes that character. But the whole time I wrote it, I thought about common.
Okay.
I actually found Common on Twitter. This is what you call stalking.
Mm-hmm.
This is where you get in trouble. And told him about the book. And if he gave me an address, I'd send him a copy, but I didn't get an answer.
Aww.
But that's who I thought about.
Now, I have to ask you about this cover because, you know, I ordered it off Amazon.
Mm-hmm.
And it came and I went, oh, okay. Now, I'm thinking, okay, a man in a tuxedo and two women in gowns. And here's this man looking like a Mandingo.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me about this choice of cover.
You know what? I actually dreamed that cover.
Oh, it looks kind of like a dream. Uh-huh. It does have that sort of quality.
And the reason he's out of focus and the reason he doesn't have a shirt is to let you know that the two women who are
making the pinky swear. Yeah.
It's more about them and their agreement than it is about him. So that's why he's out of focus.
Okay. But he looks like he's like the guy that was like out doing your lawn and then you said, hey, come on in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, kind of thing. So you know what I'm saying. So did you have fun writing it?
I loved the process of writing.
Mm-hmm.
I really did. I enjoyed, you know, coming up with these scenarios, coming up with the love scenes are really hot. I don't know if you're ready yet. The love scenes are hot. It was like, you know, at this point in my life, it was my way of having sex again.
Okay. So vicariously living through the character.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
And sort of working out, I wanted it to be about friendship. I mean, in the end, I mean, this is a provocative title, but in the end, I wanted it to be about friendship between two women.
Mm.
And so you have to see how it turns out. Some people hate it, the ending.
Okay.
Only because, you know, of course, if you're sharing somebody and one person, you know, gets into it more than the other. And what happened, I'll tell you this much. I'm going to tell you the whole story.
Okay.
He likes one better than he does the other.
Okay. But that's bound to happen.
Yeah. So when they come back and report, oh, what did he do? He took me to dinner.
Oh.
You know, he took me to the mattress. You know, so it got to be that kind of thing. So, but they had to come through a whole cycle, you know, a full circle back to what their friendship was.
Well, I'm looking forward to reading the book. Mm-hmm. So now tell me about the process. Do you did you do an outline? What was your process to writing the book?
I did an outline, and I would do beats through the, you know, the beginning, middle, and end. and then I would, it changed a lot from what I thought the book was going to be and the turns and twists it would take. It changed a lot over the course, but I did have a full outline. I knew what the ending was going to be. And
it started to sort of write itself, sort of like
the characters come alive. It's real. People say that. I was like, oh, that's so delusional. But the characters really do come alive. They talk to you, and they were like, I wouldn't really do that, you know, and you have to sort of go with what they're saying to you. And I gave it to friends to read. You know, they would say, oh, this doesn't sound right, you know. And so there's a lot of changes. I think from the first draft to the last, there might have been 12 versions.
Really?
Of the same story, but adding things or, you know, taking it deeper, adding layers. And so that's the process. The process that's not fun is marketing. Because
you self-published?
I self-published. And which is the best way. If you can figure out the marketing to self-publishing, you make them more money than you do if you have a publisher, a traditional publisher. But marketing, you know, if you're unknown and you don't have the finances to, you know, sort of do what the publishers do, you know, you have to slowly build your fan base. And that's more difficult than writing it for me.
So did you have a time of day that you wrote? I mean, were you disciplined about your writing?
Morning writer. And I would start, at first it would be like, oh, I can't stay in this room more than an hour, you know, but I'd make myself, I'd add, every week I'd add on another half hour.
Okay.
So the first week of writing was an hour, the next week it was an hour and a half. So I finally got up to where I could write for 4 hours a day.
Oh, that's good.
And I would write every day, 5 days, you know, at least.
Oh, so it was a
take
job.
The weekends off.
It was your job.
It was a job. I just read an article in Writer's Digest, and I'm sorry, I can't remember the writer's name. She writes 8 hours a day, 5 days a week.
Wow. Now, do you write on the computer?
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting. I actually met Neil Simon. And
okay.
He told me that he still wrote on his old typewriter. So that was, and then he said even after it's been made into a movie, he wants to go back and rewrite.
You do.
Do you feel that even though you still, there are things that you think about, oh, I should have said this, or I should have done
Absolutely.
The character.
You know, I should have done this, or this character should have done that, or I could have said that better, or, oh, I know a funny joke for that place right there. Yeah, you rewrite it. You have to let it go. You have to detach from it, or you could write the same book all your life.
For the rest of you. So now tell me now, what is the marketing plan? So where are you getting, how are you getting the word out about the book?
Well, I did of course, a social media blast, which I'm not great at. So, and I just recently found out about, it's called the National Book Club Conference in Atlanta. You're familiar?
Yes.
I was so impressed.
Yes.
I went there in August, and there were probably somewhere between 400 and 500 African-American women whose only purpose in coming to that conference was to buy books and meet authors. So what I'm learning is your best marketing strategy should be geared to book clubs.
Yes, absolutely.
Because if they like your first book, they will buy your second book.
They'll support you.
Absolutely. So that I'm learning, doing shows like yours. I've done a television show in Chicago. I've done some other internet shows. And you book signings and parties and all that. But the other thing that I'm learning, too, is that if you find a great book bloggers to review your book.
Right. There's a whole bunch of them.
That readers who like to buy new books all the time.
Right.
You know, depend on those bloggers to tell you which books to buy or which they think are good. So that's
you know, source. It almost seems to me like it could be a board game. You, I get your man, you get my man.
That's pretty good. Can your man cook?
Exactly okay,
so
what I'm saying.
Now, so that moves him up on the board.
Yeah, see? Now, what about a movie? You thought about...
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, actually, in my mind, I wrote it like a movie. And a lot of people who read it say, oh, this could be a movie.
They visualize it.
Mm-hmm. I wrote it probably at a faster pace than most books, where they go into every detail of the character, of the room, of the street, of the trees.
Mm-hmm.
I did more action so that you could get into the pacing and it sort of flowed like a movie more than it did, you know, sort of something that was lyrical and literature.
So it's a different muscle than obviously producing television, but the energy that goes into producing talk shows is a lot of energy to putting on those big shows. People have no idea how hard those producers work on those shows. So how is this for you now? Do you miss the TV world?
If I could find a good gig as a consultant where they think I'm brilliant and I can say, oh, that's not a good move.
Okay.
And say, yeah, I think you're right about that. And not have to do all the action and all the meetings and all the worrying and all, that would be great. But all that stress, I don't think I can deal with that stress anymore. Because when I was telling somebody, we used to put in, you know, 10 and 12 hour days every day, sometimes, especially startup.
And you raised a child, too.
Two.
Mm-hmm. How was that?
Difficult. Mm-hmm. With the help of friends and family, you know, that made it easier. But it was difficult, you know. And so it is. It's very stressful. Lots of competition. Lots of people breathing down your neck about ratings and competing for the same, you know, A-list guest. It's not easy.
And then all those crazy guests too.
Mm-hmm. Well, that was the easy part.
Oh.
You call somebody
and they're crazy.
Who's living in West, you know, wherever, you know, and tell them they can come to New York or Chicago and be in a hotel and order room service.
Oh, they loving that.
So they'll come and tell, you know, just tell all their
business.
All their business, you know.
Because we see people on those talkers go, why is that person, is your mama listening to this show? Yeah.
Or a limousine ride, but you know.
But they say, I'll pick you up in a limousine, send you back in a cab.
There you go.
So, okay, what's next for you? What are you working on? What's coming up?
I'm writing a sequel to this book.
Oh, okay.
I am. I'm very excited about that. And that's taking up my time right now. I'm not really doing a lot of television production. Like I said, if I could find a good consulting gig, if anybody out there looking for a good TV consultant, talk show consultant, I'm here.
You can consult. Okay. We need help. You can give us some tips over here.
Okay. That I would do. But other than that, I really want to reinvent myself as a contemporary novelist.
Okay.
Because I have a lot of other stories. And I was writing another story, and this is something else I'm learning, too. A friend of mine said, nope, continue that story.
Mm.
Because if they like that one, they'll buy the second one.
Ah.
You know, and if they like the second one, they'll go back and buy the first one.
Okay.
So, you know, these are the things. So I had to sort of take my other book off the table and start writing a sequel to this book. But I really do want to reinvent myself as a writer. So,
well, you have.
I have, but I want to be a successful writer who makes money.
Okay.
Lots of writers. I want to be a successful writer who makes money. And so I spend a lot of time reading about writing, reading other books, you know, and studying about writing.
Well, darling, you look absolutely magnificent.
Oh, thank you.
You look beautiful.
Thank you.
And you look happy.
I am.
And I'm excited for you. And
I'm excited for you, too.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm going to read Man Sharing, and I'm going to tell you all about this book and what I learned. And thank you so much for coming on the show today.
Thank you for inviting me.
It's been great. It's been fun.
You're a great interviewer.
Well, thank you.
Absolutely. You may be the new Angela Who.
Well, I will accept that. And you're watching the Angela DeJoseph Show. We're having fun. We're talking about writing. Coming up next, we have another female writer, and she did another fun story.
Oh, good.
About some girlfriends and about their life. So stay tuned. You're watching the Angela DeJoseph Show. Coming up next, we're going to go to a place called Poppy's Place. We'll be right back.
To those who've worried, suffered in silence, hoped, and lived in a state of fear, welcome to a new state of health. Welcome to Covered California, the place to find quality, affordable coverage, financial help for those in need, and nobody can be denied because of a pre-existing condition or a covered state.
Hi, this is Jean Noel Bassior, inviting you to join me for my new show, The Book Beat, Monday evenings at 6:30 p.m. I'll be talking to authors about their latest book, so you can find a fantastic read. But more than that, I'll be talking to experts about how you can write your own book and get it published. So tune in on Mondays at 6:30 p.m., exclusively on LATalkLive.com. And remember, you can catch us on iTunes Radio R&B or watch us on Ustream TV. Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hi, this is Starla Quarles, and I'm inviting you to join us every Wednesday from 5 to 6 p.m. for a new show right here on LA Talk Live, The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People. Join us as we discuss the topics that are relevant to today's generational leaders. So don't forget to tune in to The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People, every Wednesday from 5 to 6 p.m. right here on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, and now Stitcher Radio. Or watch and listen directly at LATalkLive.com. Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Meet Betsy. She is 29 years old and lives in Los Angeles. Recently, Betsy sent her father an email that brought tears of joy to his eyes. You see, Betsy suffers from autism, and this was the first email she had ever sent to anyone. Betsy is just one of the many students at Empower Tech, a nonprofit organization in Los Angeles that trains persons living with a broad range of physical, cognitive, and developmental disabilities how to use computers to do the things that so many of us take for granted: email, online banking, research, and entertainment. Through modern assistive technology, instructors at Empower Tech help hundreds of people just like Betsy every year. They teach them the basic skills required to function independently in 21st century society. But with new state budget cuts, all of that could change. Empower Tech needs your help if it's going to continue making a difference here in our community. Please visit www.empowertech.org. That's www.empowertech.org to make a secure, tax-deductible contribution and to learn more about this important community resource and to see for yourself what some of the amazing students and teachers do on a daily basis. Betsy and the 1.8 million people living with disabilities in Los Angeles County, thank you for caring enough to show your support.
Hey guys, sick of all that top 40 music? Well, join me, Lixie the Engineer, and Mondo on our brand new show, Band with Mondo, where we support sounds from the underground every Saturday with a new artist from 3 to 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. So tune in to live in-studio performances, Q&As with the artists, drunken debauchery, and much more, exclusively here on LA Talk Live. We're more than just talk.
You're watching the Angela DeJoseph Show. Tonight, I'm celebrating women writers, novelists. My guest tonight is Raynell Saunders. Welcome to the show, Raynell.
Hi, Angela. Thank you.
Well, you know, people think, people always say, well, how do I get on the show? You have to be my friend for at least a few decades or so, and then you can be on the show. But we've known each other for a minute.
For a minute. At least a minute and a half.
A minute. But Raynell is an actress, a model. She's a designer. She's a poet.
Wow.
And she is a novelist. And this is her book. This is her book, Poppy's Place.
Yay.
And it's heavy. And I am so proud of you.
Thank you.
I'm excited. I bought the book and I downloaded it, the Kindle version. So
that's
I bought
right.
two copies.
And you came to my first book signing.
I came to your first book signing.
Which was very exciting.
It
was
really
so happy.
Great. But you know what? You have been writing for a while because you
have.
Were doing screenplays.
Absolutely.
And I thought, you know what? I really admire you. Because
oh,
you, yes, because
you.
Because you know what? It's one thing to say you want to write. Mm. It's another thing to write. And to write a this is not just a novel. This is a tome. I think it's called a tome.
I think so.
A tome.
I have to come up with a new name for
but,
it.
But it's a wonderful book. I love the characters. So, but let's just talk about Raynell for a minute. Raynell.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
I suppose I could.
Okay. So let's talk about where you come from. So
well.
You came from, wait, you come from what? Bridgeport, Connecticut.
Yes.
And I'm supposed to ask you, are there any black people there?
Oh, you know, I know all three of them.
Okay.
Yeah, no, there are black people in Connecticut, but people used to always ask me like, oh, do you know so-and-so? And I'm like, well, where are they from? Oh, they live, you know, like an hour away up in Harper. No, unfortunately, we don't all know each other,
oh.
but it's okay. I'm glad to know there's more there.
Okay, but you, yeah. you came out from the East Coast mm-hmm. to the West Coast and you just stayed.
I did. Yeah. I always wanted to come, mm-hmm. and I decided to go to New York first because it
okay.
was one of those things, you know, if you're going to be an actor, you want to either go to New York or L.A. or both. But I said, if I ever come to L.A., I'm probably not going to leave. So I had to do the New York thing first. So
but did you
that.
Know that you wanted to be an actor when you were a little kid?
When
did you decide that you wanted to go into acting?
Well, let me tell you, I realized, and it's come full circle, because now I want to direct and stuff, too. So when I was a little girl, I was writing in first grade. I actually was already putting together stories, so I was in a gifted writing class mm. at six. So by my second grade, third grade, I was writing scenes. I was passing
oh, okay.
out the scripts, and, you know, we'd go out at recess and perform. So I was already doing it. I was casting, writing, directing, so who knew? And then I think, yeah, but I always thought it was something easy.
Mm-hmm.
I thought anybody could do this because it was really easy
you
for me.
You didn't know that you had a gift.
I didn't know it was a gift.
Mm-hmm.
I thought, you know, I thought the acting thing, that was the thing to go
okay.
to do. But the writing was always really easy. And then, you know, one day somebody just really made me feel good about the writing and that, you know, you really, everybody can't do this, not like this. So I started taking it a little more seriously and appreciated it more.
You know, it's funny. I have a friend of mine and he's a film producer and he was bragging one day about, we've got this new young writer and she's written these screenplays and there's really excellent. She was just going on. And I said, well, what's her name? He says, Raynell Saunders. I was like, Raynell, wow. So I'm like, okay.
So what were you saying? Well, she's really not that young.
No. Well, I'm not going to give it away.
I okay, don't
that.
Do that.
But I was just the fact that he was enthusiastic about
yeah.
your writing. And
oh, that's so nice
and
to
I
know.
Oh, absolutely. So that's yeah. when that's when you said you were writing a novel. I'm like,
yeah.
okay. Now, how long did it take you to write Poppy's Place?
Wow. Well, from conception to the actual book being made, it was actually about a 5-year process, but I didn't write that whole time. A lot of life happened in between that
okay.
put it on hold and, you know, delayed it. I would say maybe it took me 2 years of actual writing. And then 3 years in between was kind of, you know, other stuff going on. So I'd say it took 2 years to write this book if I had done it consistently. Yeah.
Now, when I met you, now you've made a transformation from the person that I met. Because No. I just mean because you were
okay.
corporate.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
You were corporate because you were working at
Morgan Stanley.
Morgan Stanley, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you were
That's
very
right.
short hair, very, you know, dressed for success.
Right.
Blazer, high neck blouse.
And look at, I'm trying to go back.
I
didn't
want to
come out all wild.
But I'm just saying that the artist,
yeah,
I've seen the artist in you
mm-hmm.
evolve. And it
yeah.
seems like the more you kind of let the artist out, the happier you seem to be.
Oh, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And that still sticks to this day. Anytime I go off the path, even if it's just to try to make some extra money, mm-hmm. if it's not something I'm really enjoying, it's almost like, and I hate to say it, it's like I'd rather have the struggle and be happy than to have the money and be miserable.
God bless you. Not me.
I really
not me. But God bless you.
It's a crazy
though.
Thing. But I don't have any children. I don't have anybody depending on me. So mm-hmm. if I, you know, I'm only doing it to myself, and so I feel like I can take it. I can take the heat and wait for the the glory. If I do what when they say, if you do what you love, eventually you'll figure out a way to make the money. So this is my time now. I'm trying to figure out the way to make the money, saying no to the things that I really don't want to do, and putting my energy in trying to get this thing rolling.
But, okay, over the 5-year process, how did you survive? Because you're not a trust fund baby.
No, unfortunately, I'm not. But okay, I'll put it this way. I have my other talents that I do, my crochet art.
Oh, okay. So I thought you were going to tell us something. Ooh,
No. Now, see, that's the thing. I wouldn't have a problem because I do enjoy doing some of those activities.
Okay,
if I could make money doing that, but I wouldn't do that. But I have my hats,
I
do
I have an outfit.
Oh, I forgot. Back when I really first started doing the fashion shows, you rocked a couple of those.
I did.
Tops.
I absolutely did. I'm a very supportive friend.
She is. She really is. And I did. I do like the one of a kind sexy halter tops. I do the hats, all the accessories and all that stuff. So I still sell those during the year. And that's what I love. I love that too.
Well, you know what? A woman of many talents. We're going to take a break right here. We're going to come back. We're going to really talk a lot about the book, Poppy's Place. So you're watching the Angela DeJoseph Show. I talk about what matters. We'll be right back.
Those who've been waiting for health insurance. Welcome to Covered California, the place to find quality, affordable coverage, and nobody can be denied because of a pre-existing condition. Learn more at Covered.
Watching the Angela DeJoseph Show. I'm celebrating women novelists tonight. Joining me here is Raynell Saunders. She's the author of a book called Poppy's Place. Tell us about Poppy's Place. What was the inspiration for the book?
Okay, well, in short, I actually started, I was doing a play we were doing for Color Girls. Mm-hmm. And then the director did a soldier's play with the guys. And then the girls were like, well, we want to do something else again. So they actually wanted me to write something. So the concept initially, the character started out as a play. Then I thought, okay, it's starting to turn into something else. And then it turned into I actually have a pilot for a series. I thought, Soul Food isn't on the air anymore. This would make a great for a series. Mm-hmm. And I had the idea with all the great characters and the stories that were in my head. And then there was just so much to write. And then the writer's strike hit. And I thought, the pressure. So I left L.A. for a year and I went back to New York and stayed with a friend of mine and started to write the book. And then I said, now I can control my destiny instead of, depending, on somebody else. I said, let me just go ahead and do it.
And so, your friend was nice enough to let you come.
Oh, absolutely. She kept her word. She told me when I left New York years ago, she said, if you ever need a place to stay, you want to come back and just chill out in New York, you can always come here. And she kept her word. And so I stayed there for a year.
And that's what we all need. So we need somebody we could just go stay with, and then we could just live our dream, right?
Exactly.
So tell us about the characters, though, and about how you came up. told me that it was from a real place.
Yeah, actually, there was a club in Hollywood back in the 80s and 90s.
You can
called
name it.
Nucleus Nuance.
Nucleus Nuance.
Nucleus Nuance was
hung
on Melrose.
Out there.
Oh, my goodness. It was the best. Live jazz and blues, 7 nights a week, great food, great atmosphere. That was like my Cheers bar. You know, you go there and you know everybody. I worked there for a year as a hostess. And once they closed down in the 90s, you know, a lot of people were saying there's not anything like that again. And so, you know, I'm kind of paying homage to that. And the reason it's called Poppy's Place, one of the regulars that hung out there, his nickname was Poppy. And he used to have a place. He was a manager at Public Storage and lived above there. So we would do the after hours at his place. So I would always be like, oh, are you guys going to Poppy's Place afterwards? And we'd go hang out there and just have fun, keep play cards, you know, drinking and carrying on. And it was a lot of fun. And so I thought that would be great. This way, they can't accuse me of using any real people.
Now, are those based on
the
women that you really knew?
Not really. I mean, you know, out
they
of my imagination.
Very familiar to me.
Let me tell you, there's a piece of all of these women in me, but I'll never tell what stories are actually mine.
Okay.
But there's a little bit. I think there's a little bit of all of them in me. You know,
Tell us about the main characters.
Okay, so we start off. So there's Snooki, and I think people are telling me everybody knows a Snooki. Snooki's the loud mouth, the one that's always ready to fight somebody. You can't take her anywhere, but you know, you let her come anyway. So that's Snooki, and she's always got like the fake braids, you know, down her back and swinging them around, popping people in the head. She's she's from Alabama, and so she's the crazy one. Then we've got Aurora. She's the executive with a record company, and she's very, you know, her business life is, you know, excellent, but her love life is like a swamp land. So, and we can relate to that sometime. Then there's Portia. Now Portia's married. She's a big girl with a young husband who just, you know, he's a hunk and he just loves his wife. So, you know, she's the one who thinks she's got it all together and she's better than everybody else. And then Candy. Now, Candy's very interesting because she's a very, very dark-skinned woman who grew up believing that she was ugly and then became a beauty queen.
Oh.
But her one desire in life is to get a white man so that her kids won't turn out looking like her. I know, it's a, you know,
but
terrible
real, but
thing.
But some real stuff. Some real
but
stuff,
there's, yeah, that's they're really people that are like that. And then who else? And then there's Melissa, who is half black and half white, but she looks white, but she has the, you know, the soulful side and grew up with her black side of the family. So she has that whole thing of, you know, she's not good enough on either end, you know, so she's confused and trying to fight through that. And then Debbie is, you know, she had a lot of tragedies in her life and decided that, you know, she was going to overcome them no matter what. And she feels really like the one who has the least going on. You know, she feels less secure, but you wouldn't know it because she fakes it really good until she makes it. So those are the six, right? I got six in there. So, yeah, and, you know, and I love, you know, you have to love your characters, flaws and all, and I love them all dearly because you, and even with the guys, there's some of the guys, you know, I didn't want to be the one that bashing the men. You know, people are like, oh, this is a chick when you're bashing the men. I'm like, no, really? Seriously, the men who are in there, no, they're not perfect. And there are some that are bad because there are some out there that are bad, but there's some good ones too. And, you know, and then there's a surprise really because there's more than what meets the eye. The book, if you judge it by your cover, it's just a trashy novel that looks, you know, probably a lot of sex and scandal. But there's also a really, really good spiritual message in there about life, love, and friendship. And that's really the surprise that you come if you can get through it. It's 504 pages.
You know, it's one of those books that really it's hard to put down because you get into the story and it's like, yeah, I really have to go to sleep now. But I really was enjoying it. It was almost like watching like a miniseries.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I think so too. It would have to do that. If I ever turn this into anything, it would definitely, it can't be done in 2 hours.
Remember when they used to have those big miniseries?
Yeah, they always did that.
Danielle Steele. And,
absolutely.
Yeah.
It's going to, it'll be 2 or 3 days worth.
Yeah, yeah.
Definitely.
It's pretty juicy.
Yeah. And then I do go back in, you know, historically in each of their lives, I do take you back at least one or two generations just to see how they got to be who they are and why you should love them if you're going to love something about them. There's always something there to love, you know.
So tell me, how do you feel Hollywood has been? I mean, coming here with hopes and dreams, it's a tough town.
It is. It really is. my whole thing has, you know, I came here with the stars in my eyes about being able to, you know, to do this and it's going to be easy and I can do things my way. I didn't realize how stubborn that I can be when it comes to doing things my way. I realized that, you know, I'm not here to sell ideas, and that seems to be what people like. They like my ideas, but they want to write me a check and tell me to go away. Mm. And I found that, you know what, it doesn't sit right. I did it one time.
Okay.
And I said, at least I can say I did it. Mm-hmm. Nobody can say I didn't try that.
Well, you sold a concept.
I sold a screenplay with some other writers. We had a little production company a few years back. Mm-hmm. And we literally sold our whole name. Like, if anybody ever made that movie, nobody would ever know that we wrote it. Because
really?
We had to sell our name out of it. We sold everything.
Oh.
By the time that check was split up between five people, mm-hmm. you know, it was gone in 2 months after you pay rent and bills, you know. Mm-hmm. And I thought, and there was nothing left. There was nothing. So I said, you know what? I don't want to sell my ideas. I want to make movies. I really want to tell these stories. Then I got to the point I had somebody else direct something that I thought was, you know, oh, this is great, but I'm not a director. I can't do this. And then, boy, talk about being disappointed, you know, and thinking, wow, I think I'd rather just have it, you know, myself.
But the writer has already directed it in their head, because when you write, you already see the scene, you see the setup.
But so you inspired me too, Angela, with your movie, that movie that I do with you. It's In the Bag, which won awards, by the way.
Well, thank you.
I really was inspired
by
that.
I forgot that you were in all this.
I was.
You know what? I forgot you were in my movie. You know, you're in my infomercial.
I know, I was in your infomercial.
I forgot you.
See, we have been friends, and we have supported each mm-hmm. other, and that's the way it should be. And I you know, I think that's fantastic. And I'm glad that you saw me from, you know, back then to now. And
I have a vivid picture of you, and that's why I get such a. I'm tickled.
Yeah.
Because I see somebody that really. I saw how you wanted to do this, and mm-hmm. that you did it, and. Not everybody has the guts to do what you did.
It's the hard road for sure. You know, it's the hard road, but, you know, to
so
me
what,
it's the
okay,
right
there's
one.
People out here right now that may mm-hmm. want to write, mm-hmm. and they may be afraid. They may not be living in L.A. They mm-hmm. may be in another part of the country.
Yeah.
What can you say to that person that's going to make them feel? Because you also have your family, too. Sometimes your mm-hmm. family says, you got to give it up. You got to get a real job.
Oh, trust me. Trust me. They've you know, unfortunately, you know, my mom and my stepdad, they, you know, I've had my stepdad for a long, long time, and they both passed away last year.
Wow.
Now, they never really got me. They never understood, because they were the ones that thought, you know, you in order to be happy, you're going to have to get a secure job, or you have to have a husband that has a secure
job,
or something. You go, but you can't do this. How can you do this? Mm-hmm. And I used to tell my mom, and you know, unfortunately, it made her cry. And I didn't do it intentionally, but I said, Mom, you got to understand. I'm doing this because I really love it. And if you're my mom, you should want me to be happy above mm-hmm. all else. Mm-hmm. And if I die tomorrow, and she didn't want to know about that, but if I die tomorrow, there's some really good stuff. So don't throw away any of my notebooks. I might not be the one to cash in on this, but somebody's going to, you know, going to benefit from it. But my purpose, I'm doing my purpose every day. I get up and do something creative. And so I know I'm doing okay. And that's what keeps me happy, because I'm living the life that I was born to do. Now, I'm hoping that I make some money. And so I'm doing, you know, I'm doing the things that I try, but I won't sacrifice
the creativity.
Well, you're
going to make some money, because this is really,
should make some money.
Yeah,
I think it should.
Excellent, it's a good read. It's an excellent book. Now, tell me about what are you doing to market it? How are you getting the word out about it?
Well, you know, it's only been a couple months, but so far, you know, the book signing, the parties, because mm-hmm. I'm a party girl. You know, I like to, you know, throw a party. I'm a good hostess, so I have been doing that. And I do have a friend, actually, who used to do marketing for authors and different creative people. And she, because she really believes in me and she loves the book, she's offered to help me, you know, without charge. I'm like, well, you know, when I can pay you? And she's like... Let's not worry about that. Let's make it a bestseller. Let's do that. So she's coming up with some things. She's waiting for me to tie up a few ends on some of my other projects, because you know how I can be. Like, mm-hmm. you know, you got hands in different things. So mm-hmm. I'm trying to, you know, fulfill some commitments so I can really devote more time to doing this. And then she's ready to, like, take it on the road. Let's go here and go there, because there are people all over the country, you know, whether it's friends or family, who want me to come. They're like, oh, yeah, well, we got book clubs here, mm-hmm. or we'll throw something for you. You know,
you know, they have cruises. Book clubs do, where you go on the cruise with people that just
I would love to do that. So there's mm-hmm. all those kind of things. I would love to do that. That would be fun for me. That part would be fun. And just going and talking about, you know, Poppy's Place. I think I would love love that. So
now, how did you come up with the cover, and where did you find this model the cover?
Well, I have to say, and I'm going to give my plug to LL's Consignment and Jewelry, because
Beautiful store.
Oh, it's a beautiful store. My friend Lynn Patterson on La Brea. Oh, 1205 North La Brea in Inglewood. And they have great stuff there. Mm-hmm. And I'm always hanging out there. And I actually went over there and did some writing sometime, because the atmosphere
is
such a
there.
Loving yes. space. So yes. I would go over there just some peace of mind, you know, mm-hmm. to do some writing. So one day she was having a photo session, and they had a backup photographer, so she asked me if I would do some shoes, you know. So he's just taking pictures from my ankles down, and I saw the fur coat over on the side, and I thought, you know what? I want to go play dress up. So basically, that's what happened. I went to play dress up. This is the little girl right now pretending to be a big, sophisticated, sexy woman. And I just fell in love with that. And I thought, that's going to be the cover of my book.
Well,
and
it's perfect.
I stuck with it. And I really was determined. I would look at it all the time and say, this is the cover of my book, before it even was. And then it became that. So to those writers out there, like you said, if you want to do something, if you have an idea, just start writing. Write the notes. You don't have to be perfect. I think people are thinking like it has to look like a book when you're writing it. It doesn't, because there are people out there that can help you with that part.
Did you take writing classes?
No, I really didn't. I've never taken a writing class. And, you know, I hope it wasn't arrogant of me, but I actually edited the whole thing myself.
You did?
I didn't trust anybody to do it better, only because I'm really good with grammar and spelling on top of the creative stuff. So,
okay, were you an English major?
Well, not an English major, but I always got straight A's in English. the creative part was always my favorite. I mean, I had to do the spelling and grammar, so I did it. But I loved doing book reports and things like that, because I would take
You loved doing book reports?
I loved it, because I would read it, and it would always be at the last minute. And the night before, I would just, you know, write my own stuff and, like, turn it into a whole new story. And my teachers loved it. I think they really enjoyed the process of me flipping it around into my own story and still sticking to what it was about.
Yeah. So are you still doing the crochet work?
I am, as a matter of fact. Mm-hmm. You know, as this time of year comes, you know, it's getting colder, and, you know, those hats keep you nice and warm in the winter. So.
No, well, I have a sexy, like, halter
that you crocheted
for me.
Well, every time I see that picture you put on your Facebook with the big afro and the halter
top. And I have on your top.
You have that top on.
I do, yeah.
So
that's kind of an iconic picture of me with the afro, and I have on
exactly, because it has that 70s look,
yeah.
You know. And every time I see it, I always throw it in.
That's
they're
so
like,
funny.
Oh, that's one of my tops,
that's
isn't it?
That's right.
So, yeah. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, that was the way, making money. And sometimes, I don't know, a little piece of, I've actually helped other people with their writing. So every now and then I'll get paid as a writer for hire, which, you know, it's okay, but it's somebody else's idea. You know, I do better with my own, but I like, you know, helping other people. So I've made money doing that. And, you know, back in the day, I mean, I did background work, you know, as long as I'm on the set, I like being on the set. I did work, you know, the
you
typical
some, you were in
stuff.
Music videos
and and got paid every now and then. My best I still get residuals from, like, the Nutty Professor too, when I was Janet Jackson's stand-in.
Oh, that's pretty good.
Yeah, and then they put me in, now that was okay, but you just get paid day to day. But then they put me in as a bridesmaid, didn't have a word to say, was on screen for like 3 seconds, and I still get checks. So,
oh,
hey,
well, that'll
there
work.
You go.
That'll
it pays to be sad.
Well, right now, you know, you have a lot to talk about, because you've done a lot of things, but I'm excited about Poppy's Place. I wish you the best with the book. Thank you for coming on the show today. It's been fun.
I appreciate you having me, Angela. I really do. And I'm proud of you, too, because you're doing your thing.
Doing it. We're doing our thing. Well, this is the Angela DeJoseph Show. We had fun today. Talked to Darlene Hayes about man sharing. Talking to Mary Dan Saunders about her book, Poppy's Place. I love writers. So I am so excited about these women writers. And if you're out there and you have something to say, write it. This is Angela DeJoseph. You've been watching The Angela DeJoseph Show, and we talk about what matters. I'll see you next week, 6 o'clock.
To those who've worried, suffered in silence, hoped, and lived in a state of fear, welcome to a new state of health. Welcome to Covered California, the place to find quality, affordable coverage, financial help for those in need, and nobody can be denied because of a pre-existing condition. Learn more at coveredca.com.
You are now tuned into LA Talk Live. We're more than just talk. Don't go anywhere. Stay tuned.
LA Talk Live.
We're more than just talk.